Assalamu alaikum, dear listeners. My name is Sitara. I'm a researcher in Islamic finance and I'm back with another episode today talking about student loans in UK higher education system. This is a topic of much interest to me, not just because it sits within the field of my research, but also because I work in a university, so I often come across questions from Muslim students who are thinking about studying in university and they're quite worried about taking out a student loan, which for many Muslim students, that's a common understanding in the community, is that taking out student loans is not allowed from a religious perspective because student loans carry a positive rate of interest and therefore they are riba and they are haram. And that's the topic of discussion today, and I'm really excited about presenting this today. And the reason for it is that education is so important for us all. Pursuing education is a noble goal in Islam. And our community here in Britain, unfortunately, is struggling with various issues. One of those actually is around their economic potential and their economic growth and the struggles and challenges they face around that. So many Muslims come from low income households in the UK. Many Muslims belong to working classes in the UK. And we know that the working class communities have been struggling in the UK for a number of decades now. And so education for personal growth and community growth becomes even more important in a social context like that. We also know that universities are really important engines of social mobility, and I will share some research on that with you later on in this episode. But you can imagine then in a community which is still newish in the UK, Muslims have been living here for many years, but most of the migration happened in the 1960s, 1970s. So there is the third generation of Muslims now growing up in Britain. And it's important that they have good life chances and good life outcomes here in Britain. And sometimes student loans can stand in the way because the popular understanding is that student loans are haram. Now, the situation, of course, became more complicated about 10 years ago when the Conservative government changed the tuition fee loan amount. So prior to 2012, home UK students, undergraduates, used to pay £3,000 per year as their tuition fee. The Conservative government tripled the fee to £9,000 per year, and actually now it's £9,250 per year of study. Plus, they also introduced a maintenance loan. The maximum amount of the maintenance loan is just over £9,000 for students who come from low-income households. This has had a real impact in terms of how students perceive the cost of education to be, and if somebody is going to do a standard 3-year degree in the UK, they're likely, and if they take out the maximum amount of the maintenance loan plus the amount of the tuition fee loan, they're likely to graduate with about £50,000 in debt. That's a huge sum of money, and it can act as a deterrent, certainly for some communities. We know that mature students can be quite debt averse, not wanting to take on additional financial obligations, especially when they're already paying bills and mortgages or looking after family. Similarly, for younger students, where before parents could save up and actually many used to pay university fees in cash, that's no longer possible because the amount is so very large. And so there is more reliance on loans. Now, the good thing is when you look at last 10 years' data, participation in higher education has increased across the board for all communities, including Muslim students. But we do know that Muslim students can feel they can experience dissonance and they can feel quite guilty about taking on loans because the popular understanding in our community is that student loans are haram, and they're haram because they carry a positive rate of interest. And this is my topic today. I work in a university. I often come across these questions from Muslim students, and they're really worried. And they're worried about, you know, their accountability in the hereafter. They feel quite guilty and they think, is God going to ask me because I've done something haram? And if my education is haram, does that mean that when I go into career, then my earnings are going to be haram as well? So you can imagine that this can create quite a lot of dissonance and upset at personal level. Now, when we look at matters of Islamic law, while it is important for us to exercise duty of care, we still need to go back to the sources. We need to go back to the Quran. We need to go back to the Sunnah. We need to go back to Hadith. And then and then pull together an opinion, but that opinion can't be pulled together in isolation of how the community is experiencing their day-to-day. Okay, so both things are important, and you'll see that coming up in my approach again. And if you want to know more about my approach, you can refer to the earlier videos I've done around reformist thought and reformist thinking and the kind of approaches reformist scholars take. I'm not a scholar, I consider myself a student. There's still so much to learn. So the popular understanding in our community is that student loans are haram. This is our usual approach, by the way, when we give fatwas or these non-binding legal opinions, is that we'll give quite a blanket, all-encompassing fatwa that says interest is haram, bank interest is haram, therefore student loans are haram because they carry a positive rate of interest. And then we start making exceptions because a fatwa doesn't work at that level, so we start making exceptions. And in the case of student loans, the exception is made on the fiqh concept of darura, or need, which basically means that education is now a general need, and therefore we will make an exception for people to take out loans. This still does not address the issue of whether we have understood riba or usury properly, whether we've understood the Quranic prohibition properly or not. And are these student loans actually loans, or are they something completely different? Do they resemble the ribavi loans at the time the Quran was being revealed? And do we even have examples of ribavi loans in our times? So it creates a lot of really complex questions. But the fatwa, as you can imagine, is really simple. It's actually quite simplistic and reductionist. Tends to just boil it right down to the presence or absence of interest rates. You know, if there's a positive interest rate, therefore it's haram. And actually, that's not a nuanced way of looking at this issue. And I'm not going to go into the theory of riba today. That deserves a separate set of episodes, which inshallah I will be recording. But I am going to just briefly delve into the understanding of riba that we find in scripture, in the Torah, in the Quran, the kind of loans that Arabs were dealing with at the time the Quran was revealed. What was it that the Quran was concerned about? What exploitation was happening? Why did the Prophet of Islam, Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, cancel those loans when he gave the last sermon when he finished his Hajj? And we know that he cancelled some loans at that time as well. So we need to really delve into a nuanced understanding of that. And then I'm going to apply it to the topic under discussion today, which is student loans, and then conclude with the commentary. Okay, so I'm going to be doing four things today. Just to recap, I'll briefly talk about the prohibition of riba and why God concerned himself with this. You know, what is riba? Why is it a moral legal issue in the first place? I'm going to explain its history and rationale for prohibition. I'm going to give you examples of what riba of the Arabs of 7th century Hijaz looked like. And do we have parallels today? What would riba look like today? So I'm going to give you a few examples of that. I'm going to apply my reasoning to student loans. So that's the third step. And then finally, I'll make a brief comment on the politics of this in our community. Okay, and how some of that politics is really damaging for the growth of our community. So let's look at the moral legal prohibition of riba first. And I'm going to very briefly delve into history because I just want to give you a flavor, just a sense of what riba was like, how it was experienced by people, and why was it that riba is condemned so emphatically in the Quran? You know, why is God so, I wouldn't use the word angry, but he takes such a serious view of riba, and he condemns it in such strong words. You know, in the Quran, you find in Surah Al-Baqarah that Allah says that Allah and his Prophet declare war against those who take riba. Okay, so it's a very, very serious matter in our religion. And this has been the case since the very first revelation in the Torah as well. So we know that the Jewish community was forbidden from engaging in riba. So I just want to give you a sense of what riba was and how it's changed across history, right? It keeps changing, but there are certain steady, stable features of it which we find again and again. So riba is prohibited in the Torah, and you'll find various verses around that. You'll find verses in Exodus and Leviticus, in the Psalms that were given to Prophet David, in the book of Nehemiah. And I'm just going to tease out some commonalities, okay? The word that you find in Hebrew is tarbit or marbit, which means increase. Now, what's interesting is that the triliteral root, the three-letter root of the Arabic word riba and the Hebrew word tarbit or marbit are the same. Okay, so you're looking at ra, ba, and vau. And in this form, the word riba or tarbit both mean increase. Okay, this is what the lender experiences. Now, this is really important to understand. The lender sees riba as an increase, so he's benefiting from it. In the Torah, in Exodus, the word neshech is used for usury or riba. And neshech in Hebrew means biting, okay, biting usury. It is biting usury for the borrower. So the borrower experiences it as a bite, okay? The borrower experiences it as something harmful. I'll give you a verse from Exodus. This is Exodus 22:25 in the Old Testament. If thou lend money to any of my people that is poor by thee, thou shalt not be to him as a usurer, neither shalt thou lay upon him usury. In other words, if any of my people amongst your neighborhood, amongst your family are poor, do not act like a usurer towards them. Okay? Do not lay upon them the burden of usury. Now, this verse is from about 9th century BC. So I would say, you know, roughly about 600 years before Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam was given his prophecy. I'm counting it wrong, about 1500 years before. And then fast forward to 515 BC at the time of Prophet Nehemiah, okay, when Nehemiah is entering Jerusalem. And he's confronted by a group of people who are lamenting. They're very upset about the reality of usury and the burdens it has created for them. And in this set of verses, you'll find that usury can actually damage the entire fabric of society. It can lead to widespread social breakdown. And these verses were in the context of a famine that was experienced by people, okay, when the crop failed. And this is Nehemiah verse 5:11. And there was a great cry of the people and of their wives against their brethren, the Jews, for they said, we, our sons and our daughters are many, therefore we take up corn for them that we may eat and live. Some also there were that said, we have mortgaged our lands, vineyards and houses that we might buy corn because of the dearth, because of the famine. There were also that said, we have borrowed money for the king's tribute, and that upon our lands and vineyards. Yet now our flesh is as the flesh of our brethren, our children as their children, and lo, we bring into bondage our sons and our daughters to be servants, and some of our daughters are brought unto bondage already. Neither is it in our power to redeem them, for other men have our lands and vineyards. This is a very telling verse which explains to us just how awful the reality of usury or riba is. So there has been a famine. People still have to pay the king's tribute, the king's taxes. They're already, their lands and vineyards are already mortgaged because they've taken out loans. And now their sons and daughters are being born into bondage. Okay, either their sons and daughters have been taken away from them and enslaved, or their children are being born into bondage because that is the only way they can settle their loans. Okay, redeem their debts. Why? Because the assets through which they could redeem their debts, the land and the vineyard through which they could earn some income and return their debts, they've already been possessed by the lender. And so the only thing they can do to pay off their debts is to go become slaves of the lender. Okay, so debt bondage and debt slavery are recurring themes in the history of riba. You can see how exploitative this system is. When Nehemiah heard this lament, he declared a debt jubilee and he returned all mortgaged lands and vineyards to the original owners. So debt jubilee is an established tradition in Judaic law. In Deuteronomy, a debt jubilee is to be declared. In Deuteronomy, God says that a debt jubilee is to be declared every 7 years. And so every 7 years, slaves are set free and land is returned to original owners. Okay, so the debt jubilee is an established tradition. And even now, actually, if you Google the word debt jubilee, you'll find that there are various campaigners across the world who call for the debt jubilee tradition to be reenacted again, to be reinstated again. And so government should declare debt jubilees to cancel out exploitative loans. I'm not going to delve much into Christianity simply because Christian thought on usury emerges slightly differently. And The most detailed discussions about this you find in the 12th and 13th century in the works of scholars like Thomas Aquinas, religious scholars. It's very much, the debate is very philosophical in nature, and in a way we'll end up going into a tangent, so I'm not going to pick up on that. I'm going to jump straight to the discussion of riba in the Quran. So riba is mentioned in four places in the Quran, in Surah Al-Rum, in Surah Al-Nisa, in Surah Al-Imran, and Surah Al-Baqarah. Now we know from, if we analyze the chronology of these verses, we know that the prohibition of riba was firmly in place in the fourth year after the Hijrah, when the Prophet migrated from Mecca to Medina. Okay, 4 years after that, the prohibition of riba was firmly in place. So riba was a concept very well understood by the early Muslim community, and it was a concept very well understood by the merchants of the Quraysh, okay, the capitalists in the Hijaz at the time of the revelation of the Quran. And there was no confusion about this. This is an important point. I'll build on that in a later episode, because some scholars have said that riba was not understood properly. This is not true. Historical evidence says otherwise. Internal evidence from the Quran, the internal textual evidence from the Quran says otherwise. Okay, so riba was very well understood. There was no confusion about it. People knew what God was talking about. Now, riba is a moral legal concept. I always use the hyphenated term moral legal, okay? So not only is it a moral concern, because God has talked about it, he has brought riba into the realm of deen, into the realm of religion and religious teaching. There is also law behind it, okay? So there is an explicit prohibition behind it. So it's a moral legal concept. And God is concerned about riba because riba is oppressive. And that is why he makes it a matter of note. Because remember, the Quran is guidance. The Quran is moral guidance. The Quran wants us to be better as individuals. It wants us to be better as community, as society. And so throughout the history of revelation, we see this linking between riba and oppression. Okay, so exploitation or oppression is a necessary condition for a loan to be considered ribawi. So not all loans are oppressive loans, but where loans are oppressive and exploitative towards the borrower, they become ribawi. And so you have to look at the terms and conditions of the loan and not just whether the loan carries an interest rate or not, okay? Because not all interest is riba. We also find that that scripture, or in the Torah or in the Quran, Allah is constantly addressing the lender. It is saying to the lender, you have more power. Do not misuse your power to inflict indignity and poverty and humiliation and slavery upon people. Okay, now this again is a common theme. Even outside monotheistic religions, we'll see Assyrian kings were worried about this, Sumerian kings were worried about this, you know, when you look at the economy in the antiquity. And there's a really fascinating study of debt, which is done by David Graeber in his book, 5,000 Years of Debt. It's absolutely worth a read. So he talks about the whole history of debt and lending. So we'll see that these kind of connections between interest, between riba, giving loans to the poor, and then causing oppression is a recurring theme throughout the history of lending. Now, because Allah only addresses the lender and never the borrower, we have to think about where guilt and accountability sits. There is, I'm aware, and everybody would know this, that there is a hadith report in Sahih Muslim. The report goes something like, the borrower, the lender, the witnesses to the contract, and the scribe who writes down the contract of riba are all equally guilty. Okay, so that hadith report tends to attribute equal amounts of guilt to everybody. But unfortunately, that hadith report is mistranslated. Okay, it talks about the lender, the person who eats usury, the person who eats riba. And that's how Allah mentions in the Quran as well, the person who eats riba, consumes riba, but also the person who feeds riba, not the borrower. The borrower is the person who's unwillingly giving riba to the lender. The hadith report talks about one who feeds riba. In other words, it's talking about the agent or the person cooperating with the lender to find people who are in need, bringing them to the lender, and then convincing the borrowers to enter a contract of riba. Okay, so you can see that that hadith report actually ties in perfectly with the Quran, provided that it's translated appropriately. And we just see so many mistranslations of that hadith floating about. In a nutshell, what the Quran is saying is somebody's given money to a borrower. Either the borrower was very poor in the first place, or their financial circumstances have got worse. And so the lender should act charitably towards them, rather than taking advantage of their circumstances. Okay, and that's the key message in the riba verses in Surah Al-Baqarah as well, from verse 275 all the way to verse 281. Moving on to point two, what was the riba for the Arabs in 7th century Hijaz, and what are the examples of riba in our times? Now, of course, the Quran guidance is transcendental, and we need to look at what elements are transcendental. You know, what can we take from the Quran, what inspiration we can take from the Quran, what understanding we can take from the Quranic discussion on riba and apply it today. Now, when you try to understand what riba means for the original addresses of the Quran, now remember, the Quran is talking to a living, breathing society, and I've said in an earlier episode that the Quran was not revealed in a vacuum. It was responding to immediate social needs, providing immediate social guidance and legal guidance, whilst also setting some principles for us, some transcendental principles, some values which we can learn from and take inspiration today, okay? But the Quran was talking to a living, breathing society. So when it's mentioning the word riba, it is referring to something. Now, experts in language will tell us that words signify things. Words have meanings, they have signifiers. So if I use the word tea or chai in Pakistan, it would mean a particular hot drink which is prepared using a certain method. And tea and chai are one and the same thing in Pakistan. But if I come to the UK and I use the word tea, then that hot drink is different from chai. So you can go to a cafe and ask for chai and they'll give you something different. You ask them for a cup of tea and they'll give you something different. So the meaning of a word changes from one social context to another. The meaning of a word also changes over a period of time. Like in the case of riba in the Torah, I've explained to you that people were given interest-free loans and their land and assets and the children were taken away from them. So that's also possible, that you can have a zero interest loan, but that's still exploitative. Similarly, at the time of Arabs, riba was taking a slightly different form, okay? And that's what I want to explain to you and then give some of those examples forward to our time. When it came to doing trade, and this is where I'm talking about business loans, okay? Arabs used to use something called a mudaraba. They were very clever people. Mudaraba is their own genuine innovation. They created the mudaraba. The mudaraba was an investor-agent relationship, right? If I'm the investor and I've got 10,000 dirham available, I can give 10,000 dirham to a traveling merchant, or I can buy goods, valuable items from those 10,000 dirhams and ask the agent to sell them, take them north to Syria or take them south to Yemen, where they were thriving markets. The way the profit and loss sharing worked was, if the traveling agent made good profit, he would come back and he would share the profits with the investor. If the traveling agent was not able to make a profit and in fact ended up with a loss, then the investor, if I'm the investor, then I'll pick up the loss. Okay, so it was a safe way, it was a safe business transaction for both the investor as well as the traveling merchant. That was called the mudaraba. Interest-based loans do not feature in these kind of arrangements. When we look at historical evidence, we find, and by the way, historical evidence is difficult to find because the Arabs were not writing down any contracts, so we don't get pieces of parchment or papyrus from them with contracts written down. We have to extrapolate this information from various sources, okay, including Asbabul Nuzul, which is occasion of revelation reports and hadith, which give you clues about when particular verses were revealed and in what circumstances. There are some hadith reports which give us important clues. And then scholars who've looked at seerah literature or social conditions of the Arabs, they have pulled some of this information together, okay? So we have to look at different bits of evidence to glean this picture. And what we find, as we find throughout history of lending, is that interest tended to be a feature of poor loans. So interest rates were being used when loans were being made to people who were in financial need. Okay, interest was not being used for these mudaraba type traveling trade relationships. And I've not been able to find any evidence otherwise. And I know there's lots of discussion on that. And inshallah, I will cover how Maulana Maududi, for example, was queried about this by various people who said, you know, there is no evidence of the use of interest in trade loans. And it's something that he doesn't accept. And he argues against it. You know, there's a lot of controversy here, but certainly my research has shown that there is no evidence of using interest in trade loans. Okay, so interest was being used in poor loans or consumption loans. Consumption loans are taken out when somebody's in need and they immediately need to meet that need. Generally in those times, it used to be that people were hungry or they needed some input, like they might need some wheat to sow, to cultivate, and they were struggling to purchase that, so they might borrow that and say, right, I'll pay you back later once I've harvested harvested the wheat. So interest-based loans are a feature of poor loans, okay? Because they're a feature of poor loans, they're not in Arab society, certainly they're not stipulated as a percentage. So Arabs were not saying, give me 20% on top of what you've borrowed. That was not their practice. Their practice was redoubling. And I'll explain that. So if you look at Asbabun Nuzul reports, the Equation of Revelation reports, which give us lots of clues to the socio-historical practice of riba, if we look at the work of Arab scholars who are studying Arab societies, you know, people like Eric Wolf and J.M. Kister and Ziaul Haq, who've looked at how Arab society was doing trade and financing, what kind of commercial arrangements sat there, or Meslin Cohen, who do the same for how Jewish societies were dealing with these things, you know, what commercial law and commercial practices looked like in ancient Jewish societies. We find that many people were ending up in debt, bondage, or slavery as a result of these loans, okay? And scholars bring the names of great Sahaba of Islam, actually, Khalid bin Walid, Abbas bin Abdul Muttalib, who was also the Prophet's uncle, Usman bin Affan, who was third of the rightly guided caliphs. They were well known for being wealthy, and they owned many debt slaves, so people who hadn't been able to settle their debts and had entered slavery. And of course, this changes with the advent of Islam, but prior to their practices changing, this was quite common. And the way the Arabs imposed riba on the borrowers was through redoubling. Now, redoubling used to take place when somebody asked for more time to pay. So let's say I'm somebody who's borrowed 2 kilos of dates. And when the time comes for me to return the 2 kilos of dates, I go to the lender and I say, I'm sorry, I can't return you 2 kilos of dates. So the lender says, fine, I'll give you 3 more months to repay. But now you have to give me 4 kilos of dates, okay? So the 2 kilos is doubled to 4 kilos. Now, this doubling meant that riba or usurious loans would multiply very fast, and they will become very big loans very, very fast, making it impossible for people to pay them back. It is this that the Quran refers to in Surah Al-Imran as doubling and redoubling, okay? The term used in the Quran is adafa mud'afatan. So doubled and redoubled, or doubled and multiplied. In other words, that these loans multiply very fast, and so it makes it very difficult for people to repay. And these are the loans which were cancelled by Prophet Muhammad at the Hajj sermon, okay, his last khutbah. He only did one Hajj, and when he did the final khutbah after the Hajj, that is when he cancelled these loans. And by cancelling these loans, he would also be setting people free who'd entered debt bondage through those loans. And so based on the survey, if you look at scriptural survey of what the Torah and the Quran is saying, if you look at the history of lending and how usury shows up in the long history of lending, if you look at the social circumstances and practices of the Arabs, then I've concluded from that, based on all of that evidence, that exploitation is the necessary condition for a loan to be considered riba. If the loan is fair, if the loan has safeguards in it and it's not exploitative, then it is not riba. So let's look at some examples of exploitative loans in our times. One example here in the UK is payday loans. Payday loans are given by lenders who are helping people in the last few days of the month, just before their salary check comes in, because they're struggling to meet their expenses. So they lend them money for a day, 2 days, 3 days. And the interest rates charged on those loans are just extortionate. You know, they can be up to 1500%, which is huge. Okay, so payday loans are exploitative. There is still an example of this redoubling of loans here in the UK. It's called double bubble interest. Okay, and you can read up on it in newspapers here. So what lenders, these are kind of local village loan sharks, and they know people and the circumstances. What they do is they'll give very small loans, £50, £100 worth of lending, and they will double it in a month's time. So if you don't pay it back, the £100 become 200, the £200 become 400, so on and so forth. Okay, so this is still happening today, by the way. It's not just that the Arabs are practicing riba like this, it still happens. Now, the most shocking, the egregious form of riba that we see in our times in South Asia, particularly in Pakistan and India, is debt bondage, which results in debt bondage. Okay, and this is being experienced by brickkiln workers in Pakistan and India. So these are people who work in these traditional brickkiln factories where you make bricks by hand. And so many people, you'll be shocked to hear that there are 18 million laborers who are in this position. Okay, they can never pay back their debts, and they paid very meager wages because they can't pay back their debts. The children are actually born into debt bondage, so the children are born slaves. Another horrifying example of debt slavery and riba is sex trafficking, human sex trafficking. So Amnesty International covered this a lot, and a lot of women become sex slaves because that is the only way they can pay back these usurious debts. Okay, so there are some really awful examples of riba happening in our times. And what I find incredibly disappointing is that none of the scholars of Islamic finance are talking about it, right? We have this whole field of Islamic finance and books upon books written on this, and you can open those hundreds of books, and not one of the scholars is talking about this riba, which is the condemned riba of the Quran, which inflicts such oppression and humiliation and indignity on people. And I find that incredibly upsetting, you know, coming from Pakistan, which is a low-income country. You know, half the young people there still can't afford to buy shoes, and they're going around barefoot, or they're being born in debt bondage. Nobody's talking about them. And so Islamic finance really is about the banking sector, which is selling cars and houses to middle class and rich clients, or building, I don't know, islands in the sea in Dubai, or building shopping malls in Dubai. And that's kind of the focus of Islamic finance. And I just feel that we've completely missed the point here that the Quran was making. If you take inspiration from the Quran, that is what we would be doing first and foremost, is setting those people free from sex slavery, from debt bondage in brickkiln countries, from stopping loan sharking in villages, or people taking out loans because they're desperate and they can't pay their medical bills. You know, in America, 60% of personal bankruptcies happen because people can't pay back their medical bills. That is a form of riba. That is what needs to be eliminated. Anyway, now we know quite a lot about what riba is and what the reality of riba is and what it's been throughout history. Okay, so it helps us then differentiate between fair interest-bearing loans, which have got safeguards in them and which give rights to the borrower, including bankruptcy rights of the borrower. You know, the personal bankruptcy rights exist in Britain, for example. If somebody can't pay their loan, then they can go to the court and declare bankruptcy, and the law protects them. So that stops that oppression from happening. So in the regulated sector, the regulated banking sector and regulated financial sector in the UK, you hardly come across examples of riba. Let's apply that to student loans, okay, specifically because that's our topic. But let's understand student loans first and how they work. When a student applies to university, whether that's a young person or a mature learner, and they've not got a degree before, usually that's the rule. If you don't have a prior degree, this is the first time you're studying in a university, you apply for a loan. You apply to a company here in England, it's called Student Finance England. They give you a tuition fee loan. Everybody's entitled to the £9,250 of tuition fee loan. Then they check your household income. And if you're from a low income household, they'll give you a maintenance. You're entitled, you're entitled to get a maintenance loan of up to £9,300. I think that's what it is roughly. If you're from a high income household, then you'll get a maximum maintenance loan of about £4,000. You take out the loan, you complete your study. When you finish your study, you get your first loan statement, and it tells you that this is the amount of the loan you've borrowed, and this is the interest that is due on the loan. And the way you pay back is based on your income. So you have to pay a percentage of your salary, or if you're self-employed, then you'll file your tax returns, and then you'll say, you know, I'm self-employed, this is the amount of money I've made in a year, and your loan payment will be deducted from that. And so you pay about 9% of your additional, you know, of your income. So it works like a graduate tax. It's not a loan as such. Because of the politics of it, it was hidden as a loan. Okay, the Conservative government here likes to sell itself as a party of low taxes. They did not want to bring in a graduate tax. A graduate tax basically seems that graduates make more money than non-graduates, and so they'll pay back a bigger amount into the system, which is exactly what these loans are doing. But politically, it made more sense for the Conservative Party to call them loans rather than a tax. Now, if somebody is a higher earner, they'll pay slightly more into the system and they'll pay quicker. If somebody is a lower earner, they'll pay slightly less into the system. But what is very interesting in the student loan system is that it has got what we call a salary threshold. Now, the salary threshold is a safeguard. So at the moment, the threshold is around £27,200 per year. What it means in effect is if I'm in a job and my job pays me less than £27,000 per year, I'm not going to pay back my loan. The loan repayments stop. If I start earning more than the threshold, then my loan repayments start again. And the whole thing is done through the taxation system, okay? Payroll taxation system. It means then that if a graduate, hypothetically speaking, never earns above £27,000, they will never pay back the loan. The other safeguard is that the loan is written off after 30 years. For students who are going to be starting this September, the loans are going to be written off after 40 years. For many people, especially mature learners who come back to university in their 50s or 60s, they actually pay very little back into the system because they can retire, become pensioners, or the incomes will drop and they will not pay back into the system. That's another safeguard that's been put in. So payments will stop, repayments will stop unless you make more than £27,000 a year and your loan will be written off after a certain number of years. There is another safeguard. These loans do not affect your ability to take out a mortgage, okay? They do not count towards your, there's a credit score system in the UK. Everybody gets a credit score, you know, whether you're somebody who is credible and can be given a loan to, are you good at repaying your loans and bills, you have a higher credit score. And the credit score then has an impact on what the terms of your mortgage are going to be, and you can get more favorable terms if your credit score is high. Student loans do not affect your credit score, and student loans will not impact somebody's ability to take out a mortgage, because that's normally how people purchase a house in the UK, because property here is so expensive. So neither can Student Finance England, you know, put you in jail. Now, in England, there used to be debtors' prisons up until 200 years ago. If somebody did not pay their loan, they were chucked into prison. Student loans, the government is not allowed to do that to students. So there isn't that element of oppression that we see in Ribavi loans. And it is for these reasons that I'm very, very confident in saying that student loans are not Ribavi loans and they're not haram. They do not fall under the prohibition of riba in the Quran. And the safeguards built into these loans ensure that there is no exploitation of the borrower. Now, this is different from what I would say about student loans in the US, in America, because those loans are exploitative, interest rates are higher, there is no personal bankruptcy protection against those loans, and yes, the court can send bailiffs to your door and force you to pay back the loan. Okay, so that system is completely different. To my focus today is on UK loans, and it is about UK loans. I'm saying that it's perfectly acceptable for Muslim students to take out those loans, because those loans are in effect a graduate tax, and there are a number of thresholds and safeguards which protect the borrower and ensure that the borrower is not exploited in the process. Now, I'm not going to bring my personal politics into it, apart from saying that I think that higher education should be free and should just simply be taxpayer funded. But that's a separate conversation about what government policy is about how to fund the higher education sector. My final points are then going to be about the politics of student loans in the UK community, okay? And I think that there is often a disservice done to our community, to our students, you know, who are aspiring to get a degree from good universities, to build their careers on that, to pick up the specialist skills and the knowledge that comes from a university degree. And the disservice is done through various means, okay? The first one is, and this is so common, you know, when people talk about riba more widely, not just in the context of student loans, but in general, they will often say, oh, there is a consensus of scholars, there's ijma on the idea that all interest is riba and all bank interest is haram, or any positive rate of interest is riba. And everybody you talk to will say there's consensus, there's ijma on that. But the fact is there isn't. Scholars have across the centuries disagreed about the definition of riba, okay? And we find disagreements right from the start of these discussions in classical law to later scholars of the classical era and now to modern scholars. Okay, there is a lot of debate on this, about what the exact definition understanding of riba is. And if you want to have just a very quick look at the lack of consensus, then Dr. Muhammad Umar Farooq, he is a well-known scholar in the field of Islamic finance. He has pulled together a paper where he shows that there is no consensus on this. Again, he's brought together the opinions of various ulema, various scholars working in this field. The other disservice that is done is what I call pulling up the drawbridge. So there are really popular websites and these Islamic finance guru type people who, what they're doing is they have gone to university themselves. They went to university when fees were like £3,000. There is this one popular person who went to Oxford University and was paid a scholarship by HSBC Bank, which, by the way, traditional scholars would say all banking is haram. So HSBC Bank is a haram institution. Takes out a scholarship, goes to Oxford University, taps into all of the networks, the alumni network, the graduate network that that university gives you, builds a brilliant career out of it, but is now discouraging Muslim students from taking out these loans and saying, you know, rely on zakat funds, for example, or save up or see if you can get a scholarship, and all that university education is not really that necessary. I don't think that we should be doing that. If I've benefited from university education, I would want other people to benefit from university education. I see value in that. So I find it quite dishonest that if people have benefited from university education themselves and are now asking future Muslim students to feel guilty about accessing university education as if they're doing something haram. And there's huge impact on community, okay, because I often do see very upset Muslim students. They're in a real difficult place because their personal faith is now clashing with their ambition, and they think, well, am I being too ambitious wanting to go to university and fund it through haram means? These are real genuine painful questions that people are asking themselves. There's a real impact on the community and has a real impact on social mobility of the community, okay? And improving social mobility, as I'd said earlier, is so important for our community. About a year and a half ago, the highly regarded Sutton Trust here in the UK, the Sutton Trust, by the way, are an organization who fight to improve social mobility for people who come from low-income households or working-class communities. And the Sutton Trust published a landmark research report in November 2021. Okay, they worked on this in partnership with the Institute for Fiscal Studies, which is a think tank, a very highly respected think tank in the UK. Now, the report shows, and I quote, that higher education is a key driver of social mobility in the UK. Young people from less well-off backgrounds who attend university are more likely to become socially mobile into higher income brackets. And income gaps are lower between graduates from disadvantaged backgrounds and their peers compared to non-graduates. Universities are key drivers of social mobility. By pushing this element of guilt on our young and old students and taking them out of the education sector is a great disservice to our community. Now, as I said earlier, that's not what's driving my fatwa here. My fatwa, I use the word in brackets here, I'm not a mufti. But my opinion is not driven by this. I mean, I have sat in conversations before where learned scholars have said to me, oh, you're just making something is haram and you're making it halal, aren't you? You just want to make lives easier for the Muslim community. No, not at all. I'm actually not being a gatekeeper of knowledge. I'm just being an honest researcher who's looked through this whole thing, right, in a painstaking way over a period of 8-9 years. And actually, if I think back to when I started reading about Islamic finance back when I was in university, it is a 23-year journey that I have done, you know, just trying to grapple with the concept of riba. And what I'm saying is that as a community, the popular understanding of riba is incorrect. We have misunderstood the idea of riba. We have misunderstood the concern of God's concern, the concern of the divine. In the Torah, in the Quran, we have misunderstood the idea of bank interest. And by declaring all interest as haram, we're creating huge problems for the community. So we need to go back and revise our understanding. We shouldn't be pretending that there is ijma on this and it's always been agreed upon. That's a closed question. Why should we reopen it? No, every question whether it's agreed upon or not should always be open to scrutiny and should be reopened. And RIBA certainly is a question that needs to be reopened. So I'm very clear that my research and evidence shows that only exploitative interest is haram for the lender to demand. If we were even to take that approach, which I consider a bit extreme, and say student loans are haram, I would still say for the lender, for the government, yes, for the borrower, no. I mean, what choice does a borrower have? And some of these conversations are driven by really well-off people in the UK community. So there is a very kind of, there's a small group of doctors and consultants here in the UK who are financially stable people, or lawyers, okay, or accountants, right? And they tend to fund a lot of the mosques. They tend to support some of the imams who are saying these things. And what I don't get is people who themselves have had this university education and have qualified as doctors and lawyers and accountants are now creating kind of this stigma of taking out loans when these people can actually pay in cash. So I know so many people who send their children to independent private schools here in Britain, okay? And private schools are not cheap in this country. Some private schools charge up to £30,000 a year per child. So for somebody who can afford to pay that for their child's schooling, for them university is cheap as chips, you know, £9,000 per year compared to £30,000. University is actually really cheap. 3 years of university education is actually 1 year of school education for this community. So they themselves have benefited from that, but then they would be funding scholars and mosques where this discourse is flourishing that interest is haram and riba is haram, which means in effect is that if you're already well off and rich, then you should send your child off to university. And if you're not, then you shouldn't. And I would be saying, why can't a taxi driver's child go to university? Why can't a bus driver's child go to university? What if somebody works as a customer service assistant in a local supermarket and they're being paid the minimum wage? Why can't they send their child to university? They are also entitled to have these dreams for their children and to support them in seeking education, which is such a noble goal in Islam. And what is even more worrying is that there are scholars who give these opinions who have never held down a 9-to-5 job. They've never had the need to work full time. Unlike working class individuals who are sometimes working up to 3 jobs a week just to pay their bills, they're being told by these scholars who don't work, by the way, that actually you should not be socially mobile, or your children should not be socially mobile. And I don't understand that. And then to say to people, oh, we must be patient in the face of poverty, we must do sabr, there is a glorifying of poverty as if poverty is an amazing experience. Yes, we should do sabr if our financial circumstances worsen. And this is what God would expect of us, and he would still expect us to be grateful. But to glorify poverty, to glorify this indignity at a social collective level, means that we're absolving our governments of the responsibility to look after their own people and to create economic opportunities for them and education opportunities for them. We're absolving our community leaders from doing that. We're even absolving rich Muslims from setting up a fund that would fund students go to university. I mean, what is stopping rich Muslims in America or in the UK to set up funds, investment funds, which then give scholarships to Muslim students so they can go to university without taking out a student loan? By glorifying this idea of poverty and doing sabr at this collective level, we're actually absolving people of responsibility where they could actually bring about meaningful change. So it is such an awful political discourse in the community here that it's really sad. So I think that certainly from my perspective, you know, if I'm a cleaner, if I'm a store assistant, and if I want my daughter or my son to go to university, then I would send them to university. And student loans are actually making it possible. And all of the data shows that over the last 10 years, that student loans have made it possible for students from low income households to access higher education. Okay, we call it widening participation. So it has widened access to higher education. And we should be mindful of those things. I will conclude by saying student loans in the UK are not haram. They do not fall under the prohibition of riba. They do not resemble riba. They are very different from riba. Not all interest is riba. It is important to be able to differentiate between that. And inshallah, I will be dedicating a whole set of episodes explaining riba and interest in detail, including the development of bank interest, the history of riba, Muslim students, young and mature, who want to go to university should do so with complete peace of mind. They should seek education, which is a very noble goal in Islam, and they should seek education with this peace of mind that they're not compromising on their faith and they're not doing something haram. And their education will, inshallah, benefit them, it will benefit their family, and it will benefit their wider community. I can only speak from the limited knowledge I have. I do not make any claims to perfection or any claims to certainty and say, this is it, my opinion is final. This is what my informed opinion is at the moment. May Allah guide me, may Allah guide all of us. May He give us the humbleness as well to accept our mistakes. I'm always happy to accept my mistakes and change my viewpoint, but this is where almost 20 years of research has brought me, and I want to share that with my listeners today and say, if you're thinking of university, go ahead and pursue your dreams. Thank you so much for listening. Assalamu alaikum.